Thank you for joining us on the Real Biblical Application Podcast. We have a second timer here joining us, Jacob McKinney. And I thought it would be good. We're still going to continue doing verses that are taken out of context, but also during the same time, we're going to be also transitioning into doing more parables. Parables are all about application. And since this program is about application, I figured parables would be a great direction to go in addition to the verses that we're going through that are taken out of context. And so Jacob McKinney is going to take us through a few parables today from Luke chapter 15. There's three parables there, one involving a lost sheep, one involving a lost coin, and then the third we all know as the prodigal son or the lost son, and he'll be taking us through all three of these. So Jacob, I appreciate you coming on again.
Yeah, my pleasure. I'm happy to join you. Luke 15 is a great chapter full of great parables that really all deal with the same theme of repentance. And I like how you talked about parables and application, because Jesus would use a parable to teach some spiritual truth. So he would use, for instance, in other places, he would use the parable, like he would describe how someone's spiritual state, how they respond to the gospel. He says, you know, you can look at the soil and the seeds we sow and say, you know, you use that application to show how, well, there's a spiritual truth to be found there. So in Luke chapter 15, he does that with the theme of repentance. And so he teaches this parable of the lost coin, a parable of the lost son, as you said, and then the parable of the prodigal son. Some people like to see the parable of the prodigal son as two parables. They'll say, well, there's the younger son and there's the older son, and they're both kind of a parable. I typically just refer to the prodigal son as one parable. I think it is one complete story that's best understood as one parable. But if we notice the context here in Luke chapter 15, there is some context that I do think sometimes gets left out. And if you notice in Luke chapter 15 and verse 1, Jesus is with tax collectors and sinners. In Luke 15 and 1, the Bible says, then all the tax collectors and the sinners drew near to him to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes complained, saying, this man receives sinners and eats with them. So he spoke this parable to them. So that's kind of the context here. The scribes and the Pharisees, as usual, are upset with Jesus. They, throughout his ministry, had complaints with the way that he taught and the way that he lived his life. They had issue with, for instance, how Jesus viewed the Sabbath day. In John 5, Jesus would tell a man after he healed him to get up, take his bed and walk. And well, they had issues with that. And so they had issues with so much of what Jesus did. And here in Luke 15, we see that they had a problem with the idea that a man who claimed to be the Messiah would be eating with sinners, people that the scribes and Pharisees perceived to be worse sinners than they are. So with that base, with that context, Jesus will teach them three parables on repentance to help them better understand why he's doing what he's doing in the first place. And so we notice that these parables have some similarities, they have some differences. Again, they're all similar in that they deal with repentance. It's interesting, in the first parable, we deal with a sheep that knows it's lost, but the sheep doesn't really know its way back to the fold, doesn't know its way back to the shepherd. In the second parable, there's a lost coin, and I don't think the coin knew it was lost, and the coin didn't know its way back to its owner. But then in the third parable, we have a son who knows he's lost and who knows his way back to his father. So they all kind of have their similarities, they have their differences. What's interesting is I think that they each one becomes more intimate, right? So the first one is a sheep. One sheep out of 100 is lost. You might say, well, you know, what's the big deal? Well, then the next parable is, well, one coin out of 10 coins is lost. And you might say, well, you know, that stings a little bit more, but yeah, no, it's one out of 10. But then the third parable, We have one son out of two sons, the prodigal son, who goes away. And so as Jesus continues throughout Luke 15, you kind of see each parable dive deeper and deeper. And I think you can see that each one gets a little more intimate as the teaching goes forward.
Do you think part of why Jesus is teaching this way, with three parables back to back to back, and them getting more and more intimate, to show that no matter the situation, the soul or the one that is lost is just as valuable, whether it's a group of 100 or out of 10 or out of two, it doesn't matter the person or the situation, that soul is just as valuable, and they need to be returned to the fold or the coin purse or the household, whatever it may be. It seems to be speaking to the value of a soul to me.
I agree. And I think that's one thing that you can definitely take away from Luke 15, is that whether you're one out of two or one out of 10 or one out of 100, and you could keep on going, one out of, you know, how many ever people there are on earth right now, we'll say 8 billion, your soul still has value, and your owner, your shepherd, your keeper, places special emphasis on your soul and the value of your soul. So I think that's a good application from this, is learning the value that God places on a single soul. And hopefully we, if we don't already, by the time we finish a study, someone would look at this and say, yes, every soul has value, whether it's in this part of the world or another part of the world, whether it's part of a small group or a huge group, whether it's a small church of 5 people or a huge congregation of 200 people, each soul is of the utmost importance and of equal importance.
I think that's a really good point to make, because I think us as humans, we can tend to look at the world around us of 8 billion people, as you said. I don't know the exact number, whether that's right or wrong. I'll just believe you. And we're like, I am just one person in this giant world. What difference do I make, or why do I matter? And I'm just one in 8 million or 8 billion. Sorry. And we tend to do that as congregations as well. Like you pointed out, we're like, oh, we're just a smaller congregation, in a city of Houston, in my case, that's, you know, the third largest city in the U.S. What impact can we have, or what value can we add to this city that's so large and so immense? And the thing is we can have an impact, and we are valuable to the work of God, and we are valuable to God as individuals as well. And another thing we tend to do in terms of salvation is we tend to look at ourselves and say, I'm just out to make sure I get to heaven. Mm-hmm. Or maybe we broaden it a little bit and we say, I'm just trying to make sure me and my family make it to heaven. And again, we're looking at this very narrowly instead of very broadly. And how we should be looking is, I'm here to make sure as many people as I encounter, I can have an effect on. And I'm trying to get as many people on the ark or make it to heaven as I can. Because every soul is valuable, and there's not a single soul out there that's less valuable than my own. Again, our narrow way of thinking can kind of draw us to that conclusion that I'm the only one who matters, or just me and my family matter. But every soul is just as valuable as yours, no matter if it's a homeless person on the street corner or, you know, a murderer in prison, whatever it may be. Their soul is of the same value as yours. It's not greater value, but it's also certainly not lesser value. And we as individuals can sometimes lose sight of that.
Definitely. And I think that's the backdrop of this teaching I think that the Pharisees had gotten to the point where they viewed other people to be worse sinners than themselves. For instance, in the next couple few chapters in Luke 18, Jesus would teach a parable about a Pharisee and a tax collector. So those are the two groups we're kind of dealing with here in Luke 15. But in that parable, Jesus said, you know, there are two men that go and pray at the temple. He said, one of them's a Pharisee, one of them's a tax collector. And Jesus said, you know, the Pharisee, he looks up to God and he says, God, I thank you, I'm not like other people. And the Pharisee goes on, I tithe and I do all of these things. I fast twice a week. And then Jesus said, and then there's this tax collector and he stood afar off and he couldn't even look up to heaven. And all he could really say was, you know, Father, forgive me, you know. And Jesus said, you know, I tell you this, one of those men was justified. And obviously he was referencing the tax collector. So I think that Jesus here is using these parables to say, you know, you're not of any, speaking to the Pharisees and the scribes, you're not of any more value than someone else who's lost. And that's kind of actually really where Jesus starts, because he starts all of this off by posing a question to the scribes and to the Pharisees. So with the parable of the lost sheep, the first one he teaches here, he asks them a question. He says, what man of you, having 100 sheep, if he loses one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one which is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. I say to you that likewise there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 just persons who need no repentance. So after being asked, you know, how is it you can claim to be the Messiah and yet you sit and eat with sinners and tax collectors, Jesus says, well, I have a question for you. What man of you, if you have 100 sheep and one of them goes off, what man of you won't go try to save one of those, that lost sheep? And so I think it's interesting that Jesus kind of puts them on the defensive here and puts them in the position of a shepherd, because I think if they put themselves in that position, they'd say, yeah, you know, if I had a lost sheep, I'd probably do whatever I could to go, you know, recover my lost animal. So the shepherd here in this parable of the lost sheep is pictured as someone who is concerned about the welfare of his sheep. And even though he has 100 sheep, even though he could become complacent and say, well, you know, I have 100, now I have 99, what's the big deal? We see that he's a shepherd who cares for each and every one. And so this, again, as a parable, is an illustration that's true to life. So what this parable is teaching is that God cares for his children in this way, that Jesus cares for lost souls in this way. He is deeply concerned about the welfare of each one. And so there's a really neat part of this parable of the lost sheep, I think. And it's Jesus says, when this shepherd finds his one lost sheep, they don't walk back together side by side. He doesn't, you know, put a leash on it and drag it. He grabs that thing, that sheep, and, you know, sheep, you know, they can be bulky animals, especially if they haven't been shorn, you know. And I mean, he just grabs it and he throws it up on its shoulders, you know, and he walks it back home. He's not going to let that sheep get away again. And I think, you know, when you think about that, he carried it back home so that they could get home faster and safer. Kind of like how sometimes, you know, if you've got a little one, sometimes you take their hand and you walk back with them. But if they're ever in a dangerous situation, sometimes you just pick them up and you get out of there as fast as you can. And I think that that's what Jesus here pictures, is a shepherd who not only does he care about his lost sheep, but he really wants to get them back home safe and sound. And we notice that the shepherd says, he calls his friends and his neighbors. He says, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. And so this was a time of rejoicing. And now verse 7 is important, because Jesus Jesus kind of, he's still using the parable as an illustration, but he kind of stops and he says, here's the teaching moment here. He says in verse 7, I say to you that likewise there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 just persons who need no repentance. And so Jesus says, just as the shepherd rejoices over his lost sheep that was found, he says, so there is joy in heaven when a person who was lost in sin finds their way back to the shepherd. And so back to the question, Jesus, why were you eating with tax collectors and men whom the scribes and Pharisees perceived to be worse sinners than themselves? Jesus says, because they are lost. And when they come back home, when they're found safe and sound and they're brought back home, it's a cause for celebration. And one other thing before I let you jump in is sometimes people look at verse 7 and they're a little bothered by it. They say, how is it that there's more joy in heaven over one person who is found than over the 99 people who are safe and sound? Like, how is it that God could, for instance, rejoice more over one just person, more over one person who comes to repentance than maybe he would rejoice over a congregation of 99 just persons who need no repentance? And there's an illustration I like that I've seen given. And somebody said, you know, it's like a mother who has several children. And one of her children one day gets very ill and to the point of death. But through some miraculous recovery, the child gets better again and does not die. In that moment, the mother is overjoyed that that one child is safe and sound again and is not in any more danger. So much so that that's kind of where her focus is at that point in time. But it's not to say that she doesn't still have joy over the good health of the other children. It's just that in that moment, she's so thankful that the one kid is alive and well again. And so that's how I look at verse 7.
I think the expectation is as well with this rejoicing would be for the other children of the mother to rejoice as well. We'll see that later with the prodigal son. We can see the attitude of the other brother is not quite that. And so, yes, I agree. In that moment, the rejoicing is for that one who is lost and is now found and that has returned, not for the ones who are already in the fold. That doesn't mean that the mother is not pleased with those children or happy for those children or rejoicing that those children are with her as well. But when you lose something, you sure are glad and you have a sense of relief when that thing returns. And so I think that is the picture here.
I mentioned a little bit earlier about how these parables have some similarities and some differences. And one similarity that's pretty striking is that all three parables, there's rejoicing whenever that which was lost is safe and sound again. And we'll make a bigger point of that when we get to the prodigal son. But as you mentioned, ideally those who were safe and sound to begin with will also rejoice, but we know that that doesn't always happen. So Jesus in verse 4, he said, so what man of you, you know, having 100 sheep, if he loses one, wouldn't go save it? Well, in verse 8, he kind of changes it up a little bit. He says, or what woman? So at first we have this picture of a male shepherd in verse 4 with the parable of the lost sheep. But now in verses 8 through 10 with the parable of the lost coin, we have a picture of a woman who is at home. Maybe she's a homemaker. I'm not sure exactly, but now we're dealing with a woman. Jesus says, what woman having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she has found it, she calls her friends and neighbors together, saying, rejoice with me, for I have found the piece which I lost. Jesus says again in verse 10, likewise I say to you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. So like I said, with the first parable, there is this picture of one out of 100. And now we zoom in to something that's one out of 10. And now we also zoom in, whereas once it was sheep, now we're dealing with money. And I get it, back in that day, sheep could be used somewhat as currency. You could trade for your sheep and all of that business. But now we're dealing with money. and folks, you know, when money's brought into the conversation, everything changes, right? And so with this lost coin, we see that this woman is very concerned with finding it. The Bible says that she does three things. First, she lights a lamp. Of course, they didn't have electricity back then, so you had to light a candle, basically. So the first thing she wanted to do is to be able to see clearly. So she lights a lamp so that the house can be seen. The next thing she does is she sweeps the house. So she's going to go over everything that's in there, and she's going to get out everything that's not what she's looking for. And the Bible says, finally, she's going to search carefully until she finds it. And so we have here a picture of someone who's deeply concerned with the welfare of that coin. And again, we parallel this to the great care that God has for his people. But we notice again that when this woman finds her coin, she calls her friends and her neighbors together, just like the shepherd did. She says, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the piece which I lost." Jesus says, again, he kind of uses this parable to say, so here's the point. He says, "Likewise, I say to you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents." And so again, you know, you get back to the original question in verse 1 and verse 2. Jesus, why are you eating with those people? Why are you associating with them? Well, because they're lost. Now, of course, you could say the scribes and the Pharisees, they were in the exact same state. And there's, you know, I think Jesus made that argument many times. But he's saying, you know, I am associating with these people so that I can, you know, bring them back to where they need to be. And so, again, he emphasizes that whenever someone repents, there is presence in the angels. There's rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God. And that's really a humbling thought to think about, that the creator of the universe, the one who holds all wisdom and all power and all might, the one who needs nothing, the one who sustains himself and takes takes no instruction or counsel from anyone, the one who really needs nothing from us. You think about him in heaven, and he's so concerned with our well-being that whenever we repent and focus our lives on him, it causes joy to be in his presence. It causes, you know, his realm of heaven to be overjoyed, just like we are here when we lose our sheep and find it, or our coin and we find it. Matt, I think that's a really humbling thought.
I think an important thing to point out at this stage, when we look at parables, people like to comb through parables and find out what represents what, and, you know, what does the coin represent, and what does the woman represent, what does the sheep represent, what does the shepherd represent, you know, so on and so forth. You know, we might even look at this coin parable and say, what does the broom represent that she is sweeping the house with?
Yeah.
And, you know, the lamp and all these things. People can look at parables and, you know, really take them beyond what they are intended for, and try to find meaning in every bit of this. And I'm going to do a little bit of that here, but I think now would be a good time to maybe illustrate this before we dive into the prodigal son. So in the first parable of the lost sheep, you have a sheep that wanders astray. Presumably not on purpose. I don't think the sheep wanted to be separated from the other 99 or was trying to get away from them or the shepherd. Maybe he was, and maybe that's why the shepherd had to carry him back, because he didn't want to go. But presumably it just wandered away on its own. I just imagine a sheep eating and grazing and then, you know, not looking up, and then eventually where'd everyone else go? yeah. And then with the lost coin, you have a coin that didn't lose itself. The coin didn't wander away on purpose or on accident. The woman lost the coin. And so it's the woman's fault, not the coin's fault. It's not the coin being careless or distracted or anything like that. And then with the prodigal son, this is putting the cart before the horse a little bit, but I think it's good to make this point. The prodigal son knows what he's doing is wrong. Yeah. And he purposefully leaves the father's household without remorse. Mm-hmm. Just takes his inheritance and he goes. I think it's interesting to think about the lost sheep and the lost coin and the prodigal son as members of the church who leave. Sometimes people get carried away by false doctrines. They're not intending to leave, but maybe, you know, someone gets in their ear and distracts them from the truth, and they're carried away.
Yeah,
that would be kind of like the lost sheep. Sometimes people are just rebellious and they just leave on their own fruition. And this would be more like the prodigal son. And then in the coin, you know, this coin didn't want to leave. It was almost like the coin was just cast out. The coin didn't do anything wrong or anything. Mm-hmm. What I like to look at with all these is if these were to represent members of a congregation, what is this parable also teaching us with how they are restored? And so with the lost sheep, it's carried away, let's just say, by false doctrine. It's not intending to leave, but it somehow gets separated. The response of the shepherd was to go out and bring that sheep back. And so maybe, and this may be taking the parable too far. Remember, I talked about people try to find meaning in ways that it's not intended. But this is a way that I've looked at these parables, and we might be able to gain some kind of wisdom from this.
Yes.
If a Christian leaves the fold, carried away by false doctrine, the shepherd would be, you know, someone who is in charge of the flock, maybe an elder. In fact, they're called shepherds or pastors, mm-hmm. Would go out and try to bring this sheep back to the fold. In the case of the lost coin, we could look at it as sometimes the member themselves drive others away. Maybe it's not the fault of the member who's gone, but actually the fault of a member that's inside the fold that drives the others away. In this case, it's the woman who lost the coin. And once she realizes she has done this, what does she do? She gets the others involved to try to bring back this coin. They're stopping at nothing. They're getting others involved to make sure that this coin returns to the fold. And so that could be an appropriate response for a member that is driven away by carelessness of the congregation or by an individual of the congregation, either way. And then the prodigal son, someone leaves out of rebellion. Notice the father doesn't go out searching for the prodigal son. He's not, you know, turning over stones and entering every city and trying to find his son and bring him back. Instead, he waits on the son. And so maybe we can learn from that in times of absolute rebellion where they're not going to listen, we try to help them. Sometimes the best response on our part is not to keep putting pressure on them, but just to sit there and wait. And certainly that's what is instructed to a congregation whenever someone is disfellowshipped from the congregation or leaves out of rebellion. Sometimes it's encouraged that we just remove ourselves from that situation. We're still there for them. We're happy to help them return whenever they are willing, but we're not just going to go out and put a bunch of pressure on them and drive a deeper wedge in that relationship. And sometimes people have to realize that they've lost something by leaving the fold. But anyways, do you think that is a fair way of looking at these parables? The response of the individuals whenever the coin or the sheep or the son is lost?
Yeah, so I was reminded as you were talking of, I was reminded of Jude, verses 22 and 23. He says, "On some have compassion, making a distinction, but others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment defiled by the flesh." And on these parables, I think you're right. I do think sometimes there's a tendency to overanalyze, but I think what you've said is reasonable. I think that there are, there are instances where people sometimes are out of the church for different reasons. And I think that our reception to them, the way we receive them, the way we pursue them should be individualized. So I think you're right. So I don't really have any issues with that interpretation. I don't think it changes the meaning of anything. Like you said, there are those New Testament mm-hmm. verses that yeah. deal with the rebellious brother, for instance, of 1 Corinthians 5. Paul had pretty specific instructions on how to deal with that person. I think that's reasonable. And I do see in the prodigal son, there is a spirit of rebellion there that is unique that the shepherd, that the lost sheep didn't have. Certainly you can't say the lost coin is rebellious, but even his older brother, as we'll notice in this parable here, had not an issue of rebellion, but really an issue of self-righteousness. And we're going to notice this here in just a little bit. But the way that the father, would deal with these two men, his two sons, I think was a little individualized. The way he dealt with the prodigal son, was a little bit different than the way he dealt with the older brother. So I guess we'll just go ahead and read the parable of the prodigal son here, just so we can kind of have that. Yeah. Luke 15, beginning in verse 11, the Bible says, Jesus teaching the scribes and Pharisees, "A certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me.' So he divided to them his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' And he arose and came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found,' and they began to be merry." So here's where we deal with the other brother. "Now his older son was in the field. And as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked them what these things meant. And he said to him, 'Your brother has come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf.' But he was angry and would not go in. Therefore his father came out and pleaded with him. So he answered and said to his father, 'Lo, these many years I have been serving you. I never transgressed your commandment at any time, and yet you never gave me a young goat that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this son of yours, who has devoured your livelihood with harlots. As soon as he came, you killed the fatted calf for him. Notice how the older brother, he doesn't say, as soon as this relative of ours came back home, or as soon as this brother of mine came back home. He says, as soon as this son of yours came back home, you killed the fatted calf. So in verse 31, he said to him, son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. It was right that we should make merry and be glad, for your brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found. So that's the story of the prodigal son. And obviously there is a whole lot more detail there than that was given in the first couple of parables, because those are just a few verses. But this is pretty lengthy. And as you can see, there's the younger son, there's the older son. Sometimes people want to divide that into two parables, but like I said at the beginning, I just keep it as one. But I want to just kind of go through the parable of the prodigal son and notice what we can learn from him. I think I have about 6 points of application here, 6. And, you know, one mistake that I've made in the past is to look at the parable of the prodigal son as someone else. It's not me pictured in the parable, it's someone else. What I think we can all agree on, if we're honest, is that in some way or another, all of us are pictured in this parable. And I think by the time we go through these 6 points, we'll kind of see what I mean by that. As you mentioned, the prodigal son was openly rebellious, and I think that that's an important point to note. So the first point that we can learn from the prodigal son is how we get lost in sin in the first place. We notice that the Bible says that the first thing he did was basically he engaged in self-seeking behavior. We notice that he says, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So the very first thing, what went wrong for the prodigal son? Well, he began to look at things only from his perspective. It was all about what he wanted, not what was best for the family, not what was best even for his soul, but just what was good for him. And we notice that in our own lives, our path down sin or our path towards sin starts with self-seeking behavior. James 1:13-15, James wrote, let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone to commit evil. James says, but each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Then when desire is conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. The Apostle John would say in 1 John 2:15-16, that the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, these are the areas where we can begin to be tempted, and it starts with that self-seeking behavior. So what we notice from the prodigal son is that he had a shift in his priorities. What once pleased his father, what once was good for the family, was no longer of priority to him. Instead, it was mostly about, well, what pleases me, what's good for me. And, you know, that's how it is with us. Now, as you said, there can be a tendency to want to overanalyze parables. And one might ask, well, why would the father even give his son his livelihood anyways? Why would the father say, yeah, you know what, I'll give you half? Well, you know, some people might say, oh, you know, you're overanalyzing the parable. But I think that we can say that the father just allowed his son to have free will. And just as God gives us free will, so we see that the prodigal son had free will. The father knew that he couldn't keep his son chained up there on the ranch or wherever they lived. The father knew, you know what, this son has free will. And so it's the same way with us. God has given us free will. And whenever we embrace sin, it's our own decision to do so. So we notice that the Bible says that this prodigal son in verse 13 gathered all together and he journeyed to a far country. The Bible doesn't say what the far country is, doesn't say where it's at, or even how far away it is. It just says he packed his bags and he went to the far country. So we ought to ask ourselves, are we packing our bags, right? Because this prodigal son was packing his bags, and you know, and I use that as a metaphor for going down the path of sin. And we are packing our bags for the far country of sin whenever we stop considering what God wants, what's best for our soul, and instead we start considering what's best for our desires and what we think we want and what we think we need. The far country, like I said, is never defined, but what we do know about the far country is that it is outside the safe abode that the prodigal son had with his father. So for us, as soon as we make the decision to be openly rebellious, we have, in some sense, also left for the far country, because we have willingly left the safe abode that we have with our Heavenly Father. So that's why I kind of say, you know, it's easy to look at the prodigal son and say, oh boy, I'd never leave the safe abode that he had with his dad. I'd never leave that safe place. It sounds like a place of abundance and wealth. I'd never leave there to go to a far country. Yet at the same time, so many of us, if not all of us, at some point will say, you know, I see the safe abode I have with my Heavenly Father. I see the abundance of spiritual blessings. I see the wonderful congregation I'm a part of. Yet sometimes we will exchange that for the far country out of sinful desires and lusts. So I say all that to say, don't look at the parable of the prodigal son and say, well, that's brother so-and-so who left the church. That's sister so-and-so who left the church, and everybody knew about it, and it was this big old thing. That's not me. I believe that if any of us have ever willingly left the safe abode that we have with our Heavenly Father, if any of us have ever willingly, openly, rebelliously committed sin, then we are pictured here in this parable.
And also that God is waiting for us to repent. You know, he's anxiously waiting for us. I think we all need to be honest with ourselves, because all of us, as you said, have been in this position. All of us have knowingly sinned. If you haven't, then maybe you're the Messiah. I don't know. But all of us have fallen short of the glory of God, is what scriptures tell us, and that we have all sinned. And I think the best thing that we can do as a Christian is acknowledge that, and to acknowledge that, you know, I've sinned in some ways and others have sinned in other ways, but that doesn't make their sin any greater a sin than my own. And their soul, as we talked about earlier, is just as valuable. I'm a sinner for stealing bubblegum. They're a sinner for committing murder. We both stand guilty. We both are awaiting the same punishment. And our souls are just as valuable to God. God is just as anxiously waiting for the one who committed murder as he is for the one who stole bubblegum. And that's really a beautiful picture, that no matter what we do in this life, God is always just waiting for us to repent of our sin. There's nothing that we can do to where God says, no, you're worthless to me now. Don't even bother repenting. Mm-hmm. That's never the attitude of God. He always wants us to repent and turn back to him. And I've met people who, they've done some terrible things in their life by human standards. Humans, we grade things on a scale like, oh, that's really bad, and this is not so bad. They've done things that are really bad by human standards, and they see themselves as unworthy of returning to the fold because of what they've done. And sometimes they never do because of They're so ashamed of what they've done. And we as Christians need to make sure that we let them understand that I've sinned too. This is a judgment-free zone here. We're all in Sinners Anonymous here in this congregation. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And we are just as eagerly awaiting your return and happy for you to return as this, as God is. We really want you to return. And that needs to be all of our attitudes as we try to emulate Christ and our life is no matter what someone does. I've heard of some pretty terrible situations where someone has done terrible things against members of the congregation. And, you know, it would be hard pressed for those members who had been done wrong against to let that person back in. But we all need to take a slice of humble pie, realize that we're sinners too, and have open arms for those who are willing to repent.
Yeah. So the second point of application I have is kind of related to that decision to leave. And it has to do with this illusion of freedom that people see when they decide to leave. This son, you know, he had this vision that if he left the safe abode he had with his father, then he'd just be more free. There'd be less work for him to do. He'd have less authority. He wouldn't have to answer to his dad. And he would, well, he'd just have more room to do whatever it was that he wanted to do. And I think that a lot of people today view the church the same way. They say, well, you know, I don't want to have to be accountable to God. I don't want to have to be accountable toward other people of the congregation. I don't want to have to deal with all those commandments. And I don't want to deal with all those worship services. And so, you know, they look at the church purely through that lens, and they look at kind of Christianity through that lens of, well, it's just work. And if I leave that, or if I avoid it altogether, then I'm more free. But we look at this prodigal son, and what we see is he was anything but free after he made this decision. Sure, for a little while, he had a lot of money, and he was living a lavish lifestyle. But we notice that verse 14 says, after all the money was gone, there arose a severe famine, and he began to be in want. So really, in no time at all, he went from having a lot of money to doing whatever he wanted to, and being able to do whatever he wanted, to, well, now there's a famine, now he's in want. So, you know, he kind of just went downhill pretty fast. And so we ask ourselves, this young man left in pursuit of freedom, was he free? So many people today avoid the church or leave the church in the pursuit of freedom, and we ask ourselves, are they getting the freedom that they want? Well, we notice that for this man, passion asserted itself as king. Maybe he didn't want to be accountable to his father, but we see that he became accountable to something else, and that was unbridled passion. Passion asserted itself as king of his life. Lust in his life insisted upon being served. Unforeseen circumstances and conditions taxed his resources. So in search of freedom, he ended up in a state where he couldn't even help himself. He was poor, he was lonely, and he was starving. All while, he says, the people at his father's home prospered. They had bread enough and to spare. And so I think that this is an important point, because that's so often why people leave the church. I want to be more free. Well, it doesn't end like that.
I've known of several stories and situations personally where people wanted that freedom. Maybe they're trying to get away from a brother who has a certain conscience against something. And the idea is, I'm just going to leave this congregation because of this brother's conscience. Other times they begin going to a congregation and they realize that they're a little bit stricter on certain things than they are personally. And instead of examining it and saying, well, maybe I should reassess myself, they just write off the other members as just too conservative or maybe too liberal on the other end of the spectrum and decide to leave and sometimes leave the truth because they don't agree. I think what's really important is an open mind in all things. You know, sometimes I hear things that are just ridiculous, but I take the time to listen and consider anyway. We recently had episodes with two opposing viewpoints on the Holy Spirit. I'm going to take the time to listen to both and carefully examine both and make decisions for myself. But you're absolutely right. Sometimes people are a little bit too hasty to just jump to freedom because they want freedom without considering the ramifications or what that might mean for them as an individual. And that's certainly what this prodigal son did. He didn't consider the lifestyle that he would be living maybe later on. He was only thinking about the now and like, yes, in this moment, I'm going to have freedom, or in this particular situation or aspect of my life, I'm going to have freedom. And that becomes a narrow focus of this individual. And they forsake everything for this nearsighted, narrow focus. And I think that's definitely illustrated.
And here, I think if you asked the prodigal son, hey, you know, whenever he was literally lusting after pig feed, you ask him, do you have more freedom now in your current state, or did you have more freedom back at your dad's place? He'd say, well, hey, you know, I wasn't lusting for pig feed back when I was at dad's house, so I definitely had more freedom back there. The third point is that this parable reminds us to that end of the fleeting pleasure of sin. We can see in this prodigal son that eventually his money ran out, and the money that he had, that was kind of the fuel for his sensual, sinful living. So when the money's gone, well, the sensual living was gone, and all those friends he made, we notice that they're nowhere near him anymore to help him when he's hungry. So in his state of poverty, really the only thing he had to keep him warm and full were the memories of the sinful living that he had engaged in. And those didn't fill his stomach. He instead was still quite hungry. So, you know, at some point, the pleasure fades, right? At some point, the bottle is empty. The needle is empty. If we're a gossiper, at some point, people stop listening to us because they know that we're not telling the truth, or that they know we're slanderers and gossipers, and that that's a bad thing. At some point, pornography ends. At some point, whatever sin that you might be picturing, the pleasure ends. And that's where we find this prodigal son. Without pleasure, alone, far from the Father, and never really finding the fulfillment that the person set out to find in the first place. So we see from the prodigal son that it really is this great deception, that this thing that we think we want so badly, the thing that we think we'd leave the Father's abode for, what we'll see is it's temporary. It's fleeting, and it doesn't provide us the fulfillment that we are looking for. And so the fourth point from all of this is it shows us the power of sin. This parable showed how sin took someone from a position of royalty and brought him down to a position of being hungry for pig's feed, which is crazy to think about. So, you know, you ask yourself, how powerful is sin? What will sin do to me? Well, it took the prodigal son, and granted, this is a parable, but it took the prodigal son from royalty to lusting after pig's feet. And, you know, you think about this story for Jews, this would have been awful, right? Jesus was talking to scribes and Pharisees. And so for them, the idea that a man can go from royalty to being joined to a Gentile as a pig farmer, I mean, that's just a double whammy. So this would have really, bothered the listeners. And it shows us the power of sin. After this prodigal son had wasted everything he had no other choice but to join himself to a Gentile. And beyond this, not only did he join himself to a Gentile, but now he's a pig farmer. And what we see from the prodigal son is that he's now engaging in things that once would have disgusted him. If you had asked him back at his dad's place, you know, do you ever think you'll be joined to a Gentile and be a pig farmer? He said, no, never would I ever be doing those things. That he'd say that the thought of those things disgust me. But now we see the power of sin, and we see him engaging in things that once would have made him sick, the things that, well, now he has to do. It's been said, give Satan an inch and he'll take a mile. And that's so clearly seen in the prodigal son. And we see it time and again. Judas, for instance, the apostle Judas had a little problem, right? A little problem. He had a greed problem. He loved money. He said, hey, you know what? How about I keep the money bag as we're going along? How about I keep the money bag, you know? Oh, okay. And they probably said, oh, you know, I'm mostly okay. It's just this little sin. It's just greed. Well, over time, he slowly starts taking money from the money bag. And then we see in John 12, somebody... we see that Jesus is anointed with costly oil. And instead of taking pleasure in that, Judas says, oh, we could have sold that oil and we could have given that money away. Jesus knew his heart and knew that Judas would have just stolen that money had they sold that oil. And so slowly over time, Judas is taken from this position of being an apostle, one of Jesus's 12 apostles, and the sin problem slowly, maybe not even that slowly, erodes his soul to the point that he denies Jesus for 30 pieces of silver, and his position of royalty was just thrown out the window. And you could say of Judas that maybe he became hungry for pig's feet as well. There he was with the Messiah, traveling with Jesus, learning from him, watching his miracles. Yet Judas is over here worried about money. And I think you could say that in some figurative sense, it's like he was hungry for pig feed because of the sin in his life. Hmm. And, you know, what we see from this is that there is a deeper craving that the soul looks for that this world cannot provide. And sometimes men and women say, well, I can find that craving. I can find that satisfaction in the things of the world. And so we see all the terrible things that we see today. But what we see is that when people go down those roads, it can be said of them that they're just hungry for pig's feet. And what's interesting is that the grammar here, the Greek word, when he says that he would have gladly filled his stomach with the pig feed, it literally means he lusted after pig feed, which is pretty interesting, you know, to think that you could be that hungry that you lusted after pig feed. But that's the power of sin in our lives.
Thinking about this from the standpoint of the Jewish audience that he's speaking to, if I remember right, which many times I don't, I believe pigs were unkosher. I think they were considered unclean. And so if Jesus is portraying this prodigal son as someone who is Jewish, then he's partaking in something that would probably be something completely foreign to him and probably disgusting him growing up thinking pigs were unclean. And that just kind of raises the intensity level a little bit more from what you're describing, that you can really see how far he's gone from what he once had. And I think the comparing him to Judas is a really good comparison. I don't really have anything to say on it other than I thought that was really good.
You know, we don't know a whole lot about him, but he could have been a really decent guy other than the sin problem that went unchecked. But the fifth point, and so the last 2 points here, the fifth point is that this parable reminds us of the importance of repentance and reconciliation. So we see that the very first step toward reconciliation that this son took was open and honest introspection. We notice that after he was lusting for pig feed, verse 17 says he came to himself. He said, you know what? My father's hired servants have enough to eat. They're not eating pig feed. He said, those are just his hired servants, not his sons, but his hired servants. And so he came to himself and he said, you know what? The way I'm doing things isn't working. And I can't do this on my own anymore. And he said, I need to get back to where I was. And when I say open and honest introspection, I make it sound easy, right? Like, oh, you just need to come to your senses. But people will spend their whole life stuck right there. The pride of life will say, no, I don't need help. I can do this on my own. But we notice from this prodigal son that he didn't do that. He said, you know what? I need to go back home. He says in verse 18, I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Instead, he says, make me like one of your hired servants. So some people will always just, I don't need God. That's just what they'll say. I'm fine just where I am at. Sometimes people will say, I'm not addicted to alcohol. I'm not addicted to pornography. I'm not addicted to whatever. It's not a sin problem. Judas maybe said, it's not greed, you know. And we ignore the truth. And we pass the buck. And the sin problem grows. And so as Christians, we have to be, even if we think we're in a secure place right now, even if we plan to go to worship Sunday morning, we always have to be people who are open and honest, who can look inwardly, and who can receive criticism. Because sometimes when we're criticized, our reaction is to become defensive and combative instead of looking and saying, you know what, maybe they're right. Maybe I do need to change so that I can be better. The truth hurts. To be told you're not doing it right hurts. But you know what? It's what we need. Jesus said in John 17 and 17 that the truth sanctifies us. He says in John 8 that the truth sets us free. And so will the truth hurt? Yeah, but it's a necessary step to getting back to where we need to be. And we see that this gives rise to repentance. And so this prodigal son said, you know what, I'm going to change. And when we today repent, that's what we do. We turn from sin and we turn to God. Whenever we repent, we change our mind, but we also change our actions. John the Baptist said in Matthew 3 and verse 8, bear fruits in keeping with repentance. So in other words, when we are repentant people, we know it, but it's also seen by others. Repentance then, I think, is a visible thing, not some invisible thing only. And the Bible says that for any of us to be saved, we have to do what the prodigal son did. we have to repent. Luke 13:3, Acts 2:38, on and on we could go. And so we see that after repentance, after this son changed his mind, he said, it's time for reconciliation. So not only did he want to go back to his father, but he wanted to go back confessing that he sinned against him. He sinned against heaven. He says, and we notice his humility. He said, because of these things, I'm not even worthy to be called your son. Just make me like a hired servant. And that's how we're supposed to approach God after our repentance, is with this confession, with this humility of, I've done wrong, and I need you to make me whole again. And so we see that this prodigal son knew that he was safest and happiest when he had that relationship with his father. And so for us today, we look at this parable and we say, important, the importance of repentance and reconciliation. It's something that we need to do.
Those are excellent points, especially the idea that he came back humbly is very, very important, because it, naturally, repentance should bring about humbleness, not self-righteousness, not pride, not any of those, but humbleness. And whenever you realize that you are at fault and you are wrong and that you have sinned against your Lord, there is no room for you to point the finger at anyone else except for yourself. And the quicker we realize that, the better. And repentance is not something that we do once in our conversion process. We often say you got to repent and you got to be baptized. And it makes it seem like repentance is a one-shot deal. But repentance is something that we have to monitor our entire life. It's something that we're going to have to continue doing throughout our entire life. And whenever we're baptized, we maybe have that heart of repentance. But what happens many times is people are baptized and they said, okay, I'm all forgiven. And they, over time, lose that repentant attitude. And they say, I'm all good. I've been washed. I'm clean. I'm in good shape. And everyone else, y'all are all in big trouble. But we have to maintain that humbleness. I cannot stress enough maintaining a humble heart and a realization that, as you said, we need to put ourselves in the feet of this prodigal son. We need to realize that we need to continually repent of our faults and our failures. And all of us have several that we are struggling with right now, every single one of us. And the quicker we realize that, the better we will be as Christians, because it will cause us to be more merciful to others and gracious with others and more loving towards others.
And like I said, humility and the ability to just be open and honest and introspective. Sometimes, especially, you and I both teach a lot. As teachers, it's easy to look at it from the lens of, well, here's where other people need to change. We're sometimes so good at looking at a congregation and diagnosing every problem. We can go up and down the pews and say, this brother, this sister. But then we look internally and everything's, there ain't nowhere to change. And it's like, if that's our attitude, that's a scary thing. And if a Christian, if we can't look at ourselves and find one area, at least one area where we need to grow and improve, that's scary. That's really scary. But the sixth point of this parable. Yeah, go ahead.
I just want to say, based on what you just said, that maybe as preachers, we are a little bit more susceptible to pride creeping in on our life and a self-righteous attitude, because we are put up in this pulpit or on this stage in front of everyone, and we are telling everyone the way that they should live their life. And it can cause us to make us feel like we're good and we're just here to correct everyone else. And so I believe if you're a preacher looking or listening to this, or if you're watching on YouTube, you are looking at this also. So I'm looking at you if you're watching this on YouTube. We especially need to be humble, and we especially need to be in tune with the fact that we are prone to sin and that we are imperfect. And the sooner we realize that, I think the better our preaching will come across, because instead of saying you guys are sinning and you guys need to repent, your verbiage begins to change and you say, hey, we are all sinners and we all need to change and we all need to get better. You start lumping yourself in to your own messages because of this humbleness and this realization that just because you're on this stage, you are not exalted above anyone in that audience.
I think that was Paul's attitude in his preaching. He would say, for instance, he'd say in one of his epistles to Timothy, how Paul was chief among sinners. And he would say in other places, he's not even worthy to be considered an apostle. Least of the apostles.
The least of the apostles.
You look at the attitude he had, and that's a good attitude to have. I remember, speaking of being on stage, I remember when I went to Malawi, up at the front of their church building, they have a stage where elders of the congregation sit, esteemed members, male members would sit. And I remember thinking, I kind of had a problem with that. I'm thinking, well, that's strange. And I thought, but you know what? Back home in the United States, anywhere I go preach, guess what? They put me up on a stage. I don't have a problem when I'm up there, you're right. Like I said, open and honest introspection is a good thing to have. But the sixth point, and it's really the main point, this parable reminds us of how merciful our Father is. Pig farming is a dirty business, and it's a stinky business, just like sin. And I used to be a pig farmer of sorts. And boy, after a trip to the pig farm, you'd need a change of clothes, especially a change of shoes. And there was just no other, it's hard to even describe the smell. And that's how sin is. Sin is a putrid thing to God. He hates it. And as we would picture the smell of a man who is in poverty in the middle of a famine, who's a pig farmer, we look at that, we say, man, he probably smelled pretty bad. That's how God views us when we are lost in sin. And so we look at this prodigal son and think of him for a second as a man who probably hasn't eaten very much. He's probably a dirty and a smelly mess. He's probably covered from head to toe. And I don't know if I've mentioned this point yet or not. He doesn't have food. He probably hasn't showered in a while. So we look at him and we say, that's not somebody that we'd want to embrace. I wouldn't want to go give that guy a hug right about now because he's filthy. But we see that this filthy and broken and starved man comes to his father. And, that's how we are when we come back home too. Whenever we decide to come back to God with repentance and confession, we approach him in the exact same state that the prodigal son approached his father. With this apparel, this appearance that is not something that somebody would want to embrace. And so what's our reception? What was the prodigal son's reception? We see it was embrace. We see that in verse 20, he arose and he came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. So the father, I picture him, we kind of mentioned this earlier, he was watching. He didn't leave his place to go find his son, but he was watching. He sees his son and he just starts running toward him, not walking. He didn't sit there and wait for him to meet him, but he ran toward him. And not only did he run toward him, but he embraced him and he kissed him. And again, you know, this was a dirty man. And I say all that to say that that's our reception too. Whenever we are lost in the far country, and whenever we are covered in the putrid stains and smells of sin, we have a Father who is waiting for us. And if we will come to Him, He'll embrace us. Just as this prodigal son was embraced. And I think that's a really beautiful picture. You know, we sometimes worry, well, folks are going to judge me. Maybe people won't look at me the same way. Put all that aside for a little while and understand that you have a heavenly Father who is waiting to embrace you and who is looking forward to you coming back home again.
I love the vision of God running to meet this stinky prodigal son. Literally stinky. And I love taking that application and saying, well, what should we do whenever a lost child of God is returning to their home? And if we see them start to come our direction, if we see repentance start to happen in this person's life, we see them coming our way. It had to have been a great encouragement to this prodigal son to not see the father sitting on the front porch, arms crossed and, you know, scowl on his face. But instead, excitement and running. And that can really help an individual. If someone starts kind of considering their life and they start to repent and we see that in their life, we need to make sure that we are encouraging them by the way that we are acting towards them, rather than scowling and saying, well, you know what you did. When you figure it out, let me know. You know, with a scowl on our face, rather than be like, yes, we do know what you did, but we fall short as well. And we really want you to come back to us. We're all anxiously waiting and we're prepared to welcome you with open arms. That can really help someone whenever they start to make this change, because someone may repent, but the fear of returning and being judged is overwhelming to them. And if we can at least remove that aspect of it, the fear of judgment or harsh treatment or dirty looks or whatever it may be from the equation, then that can really help someone.
One of the final points I have is I talked about the reception of the prodigal son and how that's our reception too. These three parables all have this in common, and it is rejoicing. And it's a shameful thing to think about. If somebody comes back home, if they repent, it's shameful to think that while there's celebration in heaven, there's scowling and judgment and cynicism on earth. I mean, that's just shameful. So I hope that when someone truly repents and comes back home, when they come back to the church or whatever the case may be, I hope that they find within their home congregations a spirit of rejoicing. Now, again, you can be forgiven of your sins. That doesn't mean that the consequences go away. You might really, really, really mess up, and that's going to come with ramifications. You're going to have to earn back people's trust. So I'm not saying that the congregation should be naive, especially if it was a very vile type of sin. But I really hope that as the church, we don't stigmatize confession and repentance. Like, I hope that whenever we offer the invitation to confess or be or to obey, that if somebody comes forward and confesses, I hope that we don't look at them differently afterward and say, boy, they must be struggling. That's just the wrong attitude to have. So, man, I hope that we don't stigmatize repentance, because if we do, we are pictured in this parable also. We notice that, as we read, the older brother had a really big problem with this. He said to his father in verse 29, all these years I've been serving you. And notice what he says, I never transgressed your commandment at any time. I find that hard to believe. But we notice he says, you never gave me anything. He says, you didn't give me a fatted calf. He says, you didn't even give me a young goat. You know, he said that I might make merry with my friends. We notice that this older brother has a case of the eyes. You know, he said, I never did this. He said, I didn't get to make merry with my friends. I. And boy, that's just the wrong attitude to have. And unfortunately, there probably are instances where folks have acted this way after someone has repented and come back home. And we notice what the father's response to his other son was. He said in verse 31, son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. It was right that we should make merry and be glad, for your brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found. And so hopefully, whenever someone repents and is reconciled back to God, we have that perspective of, you know what, it's right that we are merry because they were dead and they're alive again. They were lost, just like the sheep, just like the coin, and they're found. And so we need to rejoice.
I love this in the greater context of what's going on. Jesus is accused of eating with tax collectors and sinners. And I want us to also realize that these tax collectors and sinners were repenting tax collectors and sinners. And the Pharisees are unhappy about it. And I feel like this last section here really brings us back to the context where these Pharisees are unhappy about these tax collectors and sinners repenting. I think they're pictured in the son here, complaining that they're not the ones getting the praise, that it's this tax collector or sinner that's getting the attention.
It's unquestionable that when Jesus mentioned an older brother who was not happy, that the primary fulfillment of that was the scribes and the Pharisees. Now, we can become the older brother today, but I think that was a clear allusion to the attitude that the scribes and the Pharisees had of self-righteousness, of, boy, they're worse sinners than we are. And so, yeah, I do think that when you put it in the context of who Jesus was talking to, it's a more complete kind of picture of the conversation. It's a lovely chapter, and it's encouraging, and hopefully, like I said, hopefully we rejoice in repentance.
Thanks again for taking time out of your day to listen to the Real Biblical Application podcast. If you have any questions about the discussion that was had today, please email me at realbiblicalapplication@gmail.com. And remember, keep on learning and finding ways to apply the Word of God to your life.